The following podcast is brought to you by the Jonas Podcasting Network, found exclusively at wrestlingwithjonas.com.
Welcome to the latest edition of the SWN podcast. I am your host, as always, Billy. I am joined on this edition. If you're listening to this in order, I had Mikey Devine on last episode, and now I've got his Casino Brutale tag team partner on the show. It's Rabu Romero. Welcome to the show.
Thanks for having me.
I'm very aware that your name's Rabu Romero, but with my Scottish accent, I don't know if it's just Chuchterness from the, up the north of Scotland. It just sounds like I'm just garbling your name, so I apologise in advance for saying your name. It's like Carl. It's just words that the accent does not allow to say.
I have to explain the Rabu a lot. People don't get it a lot of the time, so that's fine. It's all good.
That's all right. Is there any particular reason behind it? I mean, the first question is always, how'd you get into wrestling? But we're going off piste already, but what's the story behind the name?
Well, this was, we did a training session in the asylum one night. We were just messing about, and then I started a match by doing like the leg dives that Sabu used to do at the start of matches, where he'd just fling himself at people. And I think it was actually Eddie Castle, as he is now, to get the name right, was laughing at this and whatever, and went, oh, Sabu. And I went, oh, no, just on the fly. Oh, no. Rabu, because my name's Robert, and afterwards Wolfgang said to me, he's like, you should actually use that as a name. I considered just using it by itself, and then I felt like, nah, I want that, like, that alliteration, that Marvel kind of feel to it, you know. And I looked for a bunch of our second names in Romero, because of Rito Romero, George Romero and stuff seemed to have significance, so that's how it came together.
Nice. So yeah, the Marvel stuff, You've piqued my interest already. We'll probably get onto Marvel stuff in the future. But I'll get the first question in, the boring one, the standard, bog standard wrestler podcast question. What got you into pro wrestling? What was the moment or match that got you hooked into it?
I can't even remember why I started watching wrestling, but I remember, I think it was just on Sky Sports one time, and it was coming up to SummerSlam 2000, I remember. And it was the whole storyline with Kurt Angle, Triple H and The Rock. And I don't know, I caught a random episode. I remember as well seeing a clip, I think it was from Fully Loaded, would have been the pay-per-view previously when Rikishi did the dive onto Val Venus, and remember being like,
yeah,
what? That's awesome. And then I kind of picked it up from there and tried to keep up with, etc. And I've pretty much just been, yeah, a wrestling fan since then. So, Jesus, 20 years, that's...
Maybe I often think of that. I watched since about 1999, 2000, around about the same time. And it, when you think about it, oh, it was only 10 years ago. And you, oh no, it's over 20 now that I've been watching this nonsense, this massive panto, and manly panto, is what we can call it. So 2000 is a great time to get into, because of course that was the Channel 4 stuff as well. So I don't know if you remember watching Heat
I remember really specifically being on holiday with my family and being absolutely determined that I'd be able to watch Invasion, which was on Channel 4. I remember really specifically, I don't think I've ever been so hyped for a pay-per-view before, but yeah, no, the Channel 4 stuff, because they used to have the Royal Rumble and stuff on it. Yeah.
Yeah, the Royal Rumble. I remember for years I had a friend, or I'd tape them off Channel 4, but usually my mate would do the taping, and because we all had a friend who had box, whose parents would get box office, so you tape them, and I would get the tape a couple of days later, and I'd never seen the whole of Armageddon, because when he taped it, his dad had switched to Sky Sports to see the football results before Raven versus Perry Saturn, I think it was. So I saw the build up to that, and then I saw the football scores, and then I saw the match after it, and for years I just never bothered to watch Armageddon 2000 again, because, you know, it's Raven versus Perry Saturn. It's not going to be the most exciting match in the world in WWF. And I watched it only a couple of months ago. I was like, forgot that match happened, because I never saw it until...
At least it was Raven Perry Saturn, and not like as Taker was about to push Rikishi off the cell or something, it cut to the football screen. I was like...
So I push him off and I'll see Oldham or whatever.
Oldham again, great. Cool, the news I really wanted to.
But no, that time that seems to be a big time for a lot of British wrestling fans, and that are some Scottish and everywhere in this island. The Channel 4 run of shows seems to have grabbed a lot of people in. Who are your favourites that you remember growing up then? It could be as weird as wonderful as Val Venus, or just about your standard rocks and what have you.
Strangely enough, in fact, thinking about this, I think my first favourite wrestler, and I don't know why, was Road Dogg. And I honestly can't tell you why. But I remember being really annoyed that X-Pac beat him at SummerSlam 2000 in a match that meant nothing. But for some reason, I was just really annoyed about it. And then I think he pretty much disappeared from WWE after that, I remember. I think he went to TNA not long after that.
I think he may have had his run with K Quick. And
that getting rowdy. Yeah. Oh, geez. Wow. But for some reason, I really liked Road Dogg. Don't really understand why. Then it moved on to obviously like Austin. I was always a big fan of Kane, particularly because that would have been the first Royal Rumble I would have watched in 2001. Obviously, Kane's performance in that. And putting Taz up on the top rope and knocking him off never gets any less funny every time I see it, which is great. I'm trying to think who else would have been. Just obviously all your big names and stuff. So it's a big Kurt Angle mark and stuff at the time. Yeah, and it's a great time for wrestling in general. Like so many top guys at once.
Yeah, I never really took it in at the time until going back watching it that Taz's music never finished. He was on. I think it was for years. I never paid attention. Then OSW The View did an episode on it and pointed out that the music never ended. He'd went onto the turnbuckle as it was still going, and he was in the back. As it was still going. That rumble is, that's honestly, when people ask what your favorite rumble is, every year it comes around about January, the polls go out, what's your favorite? 92 obviously goes up as a big favorite, but yeah. 2001, that's, it had the hardcore bit, it had Kane, had the Honky Tonk Man, had Drew Carey, had the Hardys colliding for a minute. The best rumble.
Had Haku coming in.
Of course.
I remember really specifically rewatching it, and I think it's Jerry Lawler goes, oh, well, if anybody can eliminate The Undertaker, it's Haku. I said, yep, Jerry, you've called it right down the middle here. That's exactly what's going to happen. Haku is going to throw The Undertaker out of this Royal Rumble. Come on, Jerry, you're better than this. What is your favourite elimination of all time, though? I think that's a more specific question that doesn't get asked as much.
You're right, it doesn't. From that particular Rumble, it's Rikishi getting low-blowed and pushed out by The Rock. But Paul London, 2005... That's pretty high up on the elimination bar by Snitsky. Yeah. I like Maven eliminating Undertaker in 2002 just because it was just mental.
Yeah, and his head put through the popcorn machine.
Good times. And just because it was amazing as well, Drew putting out Brock in 2020.
Yeah, after the build,
Yeah, any favourites yours?
Sergeant Slaughter getting eliminated in 1992, where he takes an insane, like, he runs, I think he gets bypassed, and then he just goes straight, it's like he tries to do like a ricochet dive, it just goes right over the turnbuckle, hits the turnbuckle and falls out. I don't think I've seen anybody else ever do that, but it's just incredible to watch because of the size of Sergeant Slaughter as well. Obviously the Taz one with Kane, always funny. Sabu getting eliminated by, would it have been Kane?
I think it was, Chokeslam.
He came out, set up the table, got in, got chokeslammed back outside. And probably Nakamura eliminating Reigns as well, because I didn't think Nakamura was winning that Rumble. So that was a good moment.
And a special mention to Macho Man getting eliminated by Yokozuna in 93. When he did the elbow drop and then did the pin. He got lifted out and that was it. Done.
In 92 and Macho Man eliminated himself. And they tried to kind of cover like, oh, in fact, oh god, Kali eliminated himself as well, didn't he? Was that in a Royal Rumble? Or was I think it was a Battle Royal on Raw.
I think it was a Battle Royal. Kali got eliminated one year by Beth Phoenix kissing him.
Yep, pulled him over. Yeah.
Oh, yeah, that was great. I love the Rumble. It's every January comes around, the Rumble advert hits, and that's when I'm just on the network or just I'm watching every Rumble. I'm watching them all again because they're just the best.
Yeah.
It's the best event of the year. I mean, as we're recording this weekend, it's supposed to be Survivor Series, and I can't remember when the last Survivor Series where I was like so hyped to watch it. Like, because of the teams and all that. Maybe 2001, actually.
I think the last time I was really invested in it probably been 2005 when they actually did Brand Warfare correctly.
Yeah,
they're invading each other's shows and stuff. I guess even would have been like maybe 5 or so years ago when they had like they invaded Raw. I'm trying to remember, but like Kurt Angle's the GM at the time, if I remember, because then they kind of fired back. It was all fine, but even yeah, it's just this week, this year has been really poor. But
I think that was that's when Becky got her face smashed in by Nia. I think that was only about years ago, something like that. And it's three or four, and then it's been weird. It's I don't know if we're just getting too old for WWE stuff, but I still enjoy it. I'll still watch it. That's just how it is. I've watched it for it's like Stockholm syndrome at this point. I've watched it for 20 years, and I'll still watch it.
Especially for the Rumble, no matter how like detached I am from whatever storylines WWE are doing at the time, the Rumble's always great regardless. So that's always good to get hyped up about, apart from maybe 2010. Charlie Weiss really hates the Royal Rumble 2010. You should ask him about that if you ever have one.
Who won that one again? Is it Edge?
The Edge one, yeah. Just because like half of the people in it are like basically jobbers. There's like no big stars in it pretty much. And then that's just stuck in my head because I've never heard anybody have such a visceral reaction to such a nothing Royal Rumble as the Royal Rumble 2010. But
I like that one. Now it's popping into my head. Because that had the Kali eliminated by a kiss and had the CM Punk bit at the start where he eliminated everyone and started a sermon. And if Charlie Weiss is wrong, 2010 was a very serviceable Rumble. And then Edge came back way too early and looked very not Edge-like. If I could look like that after an injury, I'd be quite happy, to be perfectly honest. At the end of the day. Right, so we've went off course so quickly in this, but that's absolutely fine. I'll speak about wrestling to anyone for hours. Anyway, that's why I've got a podcast. So early favorites, you said Road Dogg, and then obviously your Steve Austin, what have you. Did you ever have a break in between? Was there ever a point where it became too cool to like wrestling?
I wouldn't say it was too cool, but I did have a break for maybe like, I don't know, about a year or so, probably about like early 2004-ish to early 2005, something like that. I kind of came back into it around the times of that Survivor Series 2005 was kind of going on. And then that led, they had the Elimination Chamber at New Year's Revolution, I remember, that was really good. When Carlito and Masters were like the last two with Cena, and then they turned on each other and Cena rolled him up, and I was so annoyed. I hadn't even really seen that much of John Cena at that point, but yeah. So it's going to be for a while. Oh dear.
I always had the opinion of Cena. I'd have no issues with John Cena at all as a wrestler. He's our generation's Hulk Hogan, for what a better term. But there was a couple of years where I got really annoyed where he changed his like thugonomics, things like that, and then started doing the OK symbol. And I thought, nah, you've sold out, Cena. That's it. I'm done with you. That's just too far. You've taken too far.
Yeah, the weird like cosplaying as a marine thing for a while as well that kind of went on for some reason. As far as I know, John Cena's never been in any of the armed forces, but you know, sure. But no, there was a couple of years where it was like, especially when it was before the network and it was like $14.95 for a pay-per-view and stuff, and it'd be like, cool, right, I'm gonna pay my money to get to the end. Da-da-da-da. Great, okay. I've just paid $14.95 to watch John Cena win again. This is thrilling stuff.
It's that time. I remember my dad told a story about years ago. They bought, when he was younger, all his mates bought a boxing fight. It was a Tyson fight. And they paid, they put their money together for whatever it was, £14 to purchase it. And then the main event was Tyson knocked out whoever he was against in the first round. So they'd paid 14 quid to see a Tyson fight. And that was it. It was done. It's over. In like seconds, and I feel like that would be kind of the same. It's like, oh, you know who's going to win at the end.
The wrestling equivalent of that for me was the WrestleMania with Daniel Bryan getting beaten in 18 seconds, because I was such a fan of Daniel Bryan at the time. 14.95, first match, here we go, bang, and then like, are you Vince, are you kidding me, man? Come on. Like, Flo Rida had more time on that show than Daniel Bryan. It was a... oh, dear. Yeah, that was a bit of a low point. Was that 2012?
I think it was, yeah.
Yeah, because Sheamus won the Rumble, yeah.
I've never been so glad that my folks just refused to pay $14.95 at box office, and my mate did, so I got the tape instead. And then about years later, he'd stopped watching it, and he still had these 30 tapes. And I went, I'll give you £30 for all of them. They went, yeah, all right. So, and there you go. That's what saved my money there. That's got 30 wrestling tapes for £1 each, as opposed to paying £15 a go.
Yeah, that would have been pay-per-views instead of 30 tapes.
Exactly. And then the network came along, and now I've got I've got 30 tapes and among other 300 odd DVDs and VHS is just gathering dust, because what's the point? I've got the network.
I've got a bunch of old, like, wrestling, like, compilation, or, like, you know, like Ric Flair or Bret Hart or whatever, and they obviously just sit there because it's like all the matches are on the network anyway, so...
Yeah. And they're currently in my parents' loft, because every time I even suggest taking them into the house, they're just like, my wife's just like, no, you've so much shit in this house already, as you can see from my background, that no, you do not need like 3-4 boxes of wrestling DVDs and videos to go in with it. It's like, ah, they're mine. They should be in my house. But yeah, that's every time she brings up an extension, like, we'll get an extension, we'll make the bedroom bigger. I'm like, that's great. I can have a room for all my DVDs. And then, no, maybe not. We might not do the extension yet then. So you had a little bit of a break in that point and came back to it for that Survivor Series, which I think I may end up watching this week, because I forgot how into the brand warfare it was at that point.
It stands up, man, especially the ending, just for Orton's face when Taker comes back. Just love it.
Yeah, that's definitely getting watched. So how did you go from just watch? Were you aware of Scottish wrestling before you actually pursued training it or anything like that?
Yes, well, I went to a couple of ICW shows in, like, maybe, I think it'd have been like 2013, 2014. I think one of the first ones was when Rhino was there. I seem to remember it being in like the ABC. In fact, I think it was the one that it was Jester won the title. I think that was the first one I went to.
So I went not here, man, was it? I think it was.
It'd have been around the point as well when Devitt dropped in for like two shows or whatever. That'd have been like maybe two shows after that or something. But yeah, so I've been to a couple of those or whatever, but I never really thought it was a viable thing to do. It wasn't until the end of 2015, start of 2016, I actually started training for Tough Mudder. And it got to about the middle of the year. I did Tough Mudder, and then I was like, I'm actually in quite good shape. Like, I wonder if I could actually give wrestling a go. I wonder if it's actually something, like, even just, you know, to see what it was like or whatever. Literally typed in, you know, like, Glasgow Wrestling or whatever, the very first thing that came up, Glasgow Pro Wrestling Asylum. There's an intake in like 2 weeks or whatever. I was like, great, I'll jump in for that and see how it is. And yeah, no, I just loved it ever since. It's been great.
So I may ask a lot of people from GPWA when I speak to them, when you go to ICW beforehand and you see Jester, in your case, you would have just been bleeding everywhere at that point. and then you see guys like BT Gunn and what have you, and Wolfgang. And then you sign up for GPWA and you get to see these guys like in real life. Was there any like trepidation, like going, oh God, what are you going to teach me how to swing barbed wire bats or anything like that? What was your first game to do? Like,
well, they make it pretty clear, because there's some people who go in and expect to be doing like promos and stuff in like the first weeks, but like they had it all set up, so it was like, cool, you've got 8 weeks to do. You're just doing like forward rolls, your basic bumps, like. Just basically, can you do this without being a danger to yourself and everyone else around you? And then we'll kind of really teach you to wrestle. So they make it pretty clear what you're getting into from the beginning. There's quite a lot of... There's been quite a few times I've heard about people dropping out almost immediately because of, like, when we go in, it would be like, cool, do 10 squats for everybody there. So you normally have a class about, like, it started off with 25 people and then it would dwindle. But so you'd end up like doing like 250 squats just to start, and you'd see people kind of going like, God, I didn't know being a wrestler meant you had to like exert yourself, like, this isn't for me. And it's like, what did you expect? So no barbed wire bat worry, fortunately, although it was a little bit surreal to see guys obviously you've seen on shows and stuff, just teaching you how to do a lockup and stuff like that. The first time that I met Wolfie, I didn't actually realise that it was him because he was wearing, he likes to wear like a bandana and a buff. So like he was like the other end of the room. And I can't even remember what he was saying or whatever, but it wasn't until later on that I was like, oh, that's Wolfgang. All right, okay, right, okay, no, I don't know who that is.
Did you have a character in mind then when you came in? Because I have heard stories, not from GPWA, but elsewhere, of guys that come to training that have done a bit of backyarding. They've had their trampoline kitted out, and they come in with a character and a promo and a name, and already have their gear, which is probably jeans and cowboy boots or something, you know? did you ever have a character in mind growing up, or did you do anything like e-fedding?
No, nothing like that. When I first started at GPWA, I was really into Japanese wrestling and stuff. I love anime and whatever, and I was like, oh, I wonder if I could do like something along those lines. Obviously it never, you know, ended up panning out and stuff, but that was the kind of angle to do. I was like, oh man, I could do like a character like the Great Muta or something, or I could do like this or that. But yeah, no, just not the most relatable characters, or not really ideal for connecting with a casual like family audience or whatever. So yeah, probably glad that went by the wayside, to be honest.
So you said the 250 squats, which my knees just hurt the mere sound of that. So you say you're kind of, you thought you're fit enough to do it. 250 squats later. What was the first hurdle you had to have? Was it getting your footwork right? Was it the ropes? Was it hitting the mat? What was your kind of first
there wasn't anything particularly, you know, like the basic stuff is also just different types of rolls. Well, they're not expecting anything too much from you in the first 8 weeks. However, again, it's just to make sure that you're not like, well, there were a lot of people coming and couldn't do a forward roll and stuff, and it's like, okay, well, this probably isn't for you. I don't know, what it wasn't until we started to get into more stuff after the initial 8 weeks, like doing like basic sequences and like more moves, like hip tosses, arm drags, etc. That's more when you start to kind of, the difficulty starts to ramp up a little bit. Some people take it really, really naturally with, you know, kind of every move. Sometimes there's just moves that certain people just seem to have a thing in their head about, and they really need to work at it. So
nothing too taxing that you found in your initial start, anyway?
No, not in the initial starting period, no. It's more when you get to the point of, you know, you start to have matches and training and stuff, and then you realise that you're in the ring and you've got to try and think about 100 different things at once, and you've got to think about, you know, pacing, selling, like your positioning, like you say, your footwork, all that kind of stuff, and then making everything look crisp, make sure your strikes are good, etc., but still like do character work, still, you know, make yourself consistent, remember what the next spot is, make sure that the other guy knows what the next spot is, etc. So yeah, that's more when it starts to all kind of come together.
Yeah, again, much like the squats, just mere signs that my brain's already kind of scrambled, just thinking, I'd rather just want to get out and make sure that I'm alive at the end of it. But then you got to remember, like you say, all these things about, and because we'll get on to your actual matches, but because you're a tag team wrestler as well, there's a little bit less physical, but that means there's a whole lot more mental that you got to think of as well. And it's just,
yeah,
it's mind boggling. But before you actually wrestled though, or before you made your debut, I think you made an appearance in ICW as a referee.
I did.
Because of things that happened last year, we have to be very careful with names as we're going along this, but we'll try our best. There was a false count anywhere match including Joe Hendry.
No, that one wasn't me.
Was it not you? Okay. Okay. There was a false count anywhere match involving people.
Yep.
The
thing that I mainly did with the refereeing was there was a storyline to do with a contract for a match at the Hydro, and I was essentially like when they used to have like the hardcore title, I'd be running about with whoever had the contract and stuff. So they did like a bunch of skits and stuff backstage and stuff for it. Had to referee a couple of actual matches on shows and stuff for it. No, I actually went down to a charity football match with Ravy Davey to do a skit with it as well, which was got to meet Daddy Riga. That was great. Actually, that was a good day. That was an interesting period of time.
So how were you approached with that? Was it just one of your coaches recommended you, going, oh, he can do this? Or were you, how did that get set up?
I can't even remember exactly how it came in. They needed somebody for a referee thing. I'd been doing ring crew and stuff for a while. I think I was just standing about. I think it could have been anybody, to be honest. I'm not really sure. Well, I guess they would have done a couple of skits, and then if the person was any good, they'd probably pick somebody else. But apparently, I was good enough to do that. So, it was fun. It was good. Some of the stuff was fun for that.
So, how did you find refereeing in general then? Because it's a little bit less actual physical. You doing the wrestling bit of it, but as I've spoken to a couple of referees, to Chris Quinn, who does ICW refereeing, it's there's a lot more to it than you think with refereeing. So was that a learning curve for you for
yeah.
that?
Yeah, well, I wouldn't. I also wouldn't put myself in the level of actual referees and stuff, because I only did like a handful of matches or whatever. But I guess still things, being a good referee is, when you don't even notice that he's there, kind of thing. So, and a lot of the time it's kind of anticipation. So, like, what moves coming, like what position have you got to be into, be counting the shoulders, etc. Like, making sure that if there's a hard cam, that you're not in the way of that. That if they're going for some kind of spot or whatever, that you can basically read the match while you're doing that. But then, depending on what type of show it is, you might have, like a wire in your ear kind of giving you feedback and, trying to relay stuff to the wrestlers, etc. So, there's a lot more to it than you'd expect, rather than just slapping your hand on the mat a couple of times.
That was where I first like recognized you. And then when videos or pictures went up of your debut time, whether cage match is correct or not, I'll find out shortly. I was looking at it going, that's the referee. That's the referee guy that's now wrestling. It just happened. So according to Cage Match, which is it's hit or miss with reliability at the moment, you made your debut in 2018 against Charlie Vice.
I am going to have to listen. I didn't realise that match was on Cage Match.
Oh, you do have a profile, unfortunately, so I had to
So do you just pull it from random shows and stuff?
Well, I was very much certain that you would have made your debut at GPWA or Wrestling Experience Scotland. So unless Lionheart pulled you in for PWE, then I was feeling fairly confident that's where I'd find your first match.
Well, funnily enough, I did do one match before I debuted in the Asylum, but it was down in Sunderland. It was just a random tag match. It wasn't like a big show or anything, but it was okay. It was like a three-way tag match. I was tagging my guy I'd never met before. In terms of, the kind of first time I'd ever been in front of a crowd or whatever, it kind of went okay. But yeah, no, it's kind of like non-canon. Let's go for that. It's like an anime movie. Just that's not the official timeline. Officially, yes, me against Charlie Vice in the Asylum in September 2018, I want to say.
I just wrote down 2018 because I thought, why write down the month? That would make too much sense. we'll go back to that then. Was it Up Brawl then, Sunderland?
Yeah. It was
That always seems to be where Scottish guys pop up when it comes to going down south. Up Brawl seems to nab them first. I don't know why. I don't know how. So first match then. Well, the non-canon first match, the unofficial first match, a tag team match, teaming with someone you don't know in a crowd that wouldn't have seen you because it's Sunderland. It's not like GPWA or even an ICW would have at least seen your face at some point. You said it went quite well, but what was there nerves or were you kind of just dragged down to be part of the show?
I don't know. I was nervous, obviously, because it was kind of like, I've trained to do this thing for a while, but can I actually do it when it's a real situation, etc. But now, in terms of I didn't mess anything up. There weren't any major botches. We told a pretty okay wee story kind of thing for a throwaway three tag team match. Nothing to write home about, but at the same time, not a horror show. So it did give me some confidence that I can do this, especially since it was a match that we planned, in like 10 minutes and with that number of participants, etc. It definitely gave me a kind of shot in the arm, like, cool, no, this is, I'm not going to wilt under the pressure of even a couple of people in an audience looking at me while I'm in a wrestling ring. So,
throwing in the deep end, for sure. So, that's non canon. That's the Netflix series, and now we're into the MCU. Yeah. So 2018, your actual debut, September 18 against Charlie Vice. And so this is against this would be in front of a crowd and your coaches and your peers that have all eyes on you, ready to give you feedback afterwards. How did you find out you're having your first match, and then how did you find the match itself?
It was actually pretty funny how I found it. So like the five pound ones used to get posted on the Facebook group we had for the asylum. So be like, okay, cool, this is the card for this date, blah blah blah. And I was like, I'd been training for a couple of years, and I was like, oh, I'm waiting for my debut, blah blah. And I remember every time one of these cards would come up, I'd look at it and I'd scroll through, and I'd go, oh, I'm not on it. Oh, shucks. And I get it, whatever. And then this one time, I remember, I think I'd come home from work and I fell asleep, and I woke up and I had a bunch of messages, and one of them was from Charlie, funnily enough. And to drop my one bomb here, I guess I'm quoting it actually, so it's probably okay. The exact quote was, "It's happening, you big bastard. Check the Facebook page." And obviously, you know, there it was, you know, Charlie Vice, Rabu Romero. That was great. I couldn't have picked Charlie's one of my best friends. So couldn't have picked a better person to have my first canon match against. So that was great. I'd already worked with him a bunch of times in training and stuff. So we put that match together in like 10 minutes or something, not long before we went out. Our time got cut when we were out there a little bit as well, but we were able to, you know, just cut stuff out, flowed pretty seamlessly. Again, everything went pretty well. So I was really happy with that for my first match, I must say.
I seem the last few folk I've spoken to, Charlie seems to be their first opponent. I don't know whether he's just quite an even-headed person. What's that word? But he just feel comfortable in the ring, and he's able just to do what you need to do.
It's the old, you know, a good wrestler can have a good match with a broom, and in Charlie's case, he can. So that day, I was the broom. I guess that's why he was just like a gatekeeper for a while, just a nice, you know, easy person to work with, nice like show opener or second match kind of thing. I've actually got a framed picture in my living room of Charlie forearming me, which he gave me for my birthday. That was very nice of him. He was very happy to give me that picture.
That's amazing. Did he sign it as well?
He basically signed my jaw that day, so I think that was enough. But he also has the corresponding picture of his arm raised in victory in his house, so very, very nice.
That's amazing. So you said you're training for a couple of years, and you saw these match cards going up. Was there ever a point where you were thinking, oh, this maybe it's just never my time, or were you always given quite good, were you always kind of, I don't know how to phrase it, but your coaches were always like, no, you're doing fine, you'll get your time, kind of thing. They're able to keep you going.
There were times where I was obviously frustrated about it, etc. But you know what can you do? I wasn't going to give up because I love pro wrestling. I definitely wasn't going to give up before I at least made my debut, etc. So just had to kind of plow away through it. Still got to obviously do other stuff. Got to meet loads of people in pro wrestling that, you know, I'd seen on shows and stuff. So that was always cool. Was still, you know, still enjoyed training every week, etc. So even though I wasn't getting my debut, I was still, you know, I wasn't hating pro wrestling or anything. So it was okay.
Any of those meets that you're just like, I can't believe that either they're so nice, or depending on whether they're still around or not, you met someone in particular like, you weren't as cool as I thought you were going to be. Anyone like that? I mean, ICW ones, they had a lot of weird and wonderful people from all over the world pop in at some point that you may have interacted with. But any stories from that?
I just remember, well, but the one that jumps out is was RVD when he did Fear and Loathing, the Hydro. And I had to do some of the security work for when they were doing the meet and greet. So it was RVD, Kevin Nash, and Rey Mysterio. Also sat next to Rey Mysterio and catering, didn't realise who he was, which was pretty funny. So I don't think I'd seen him without his mask since WCW or something, like what you're talking about, 2000. But it was only when he was talking to Nash that I was like, oh my God. Okay, right. Okay, that makes sense. But no, just like that line was so long for that meet and greet. But every single person that came by, RVD said, like, just absolutely buzzing. Rob Van Dam. Every single person, absolutely buzzing to sign all the stuff. Like, Yeah, no, he couldn't have been any nicer or more energetic, especially for a guy that's also been wrestling as long as he has. So
I'll throw in my one story of doing that. I did a security for Drew, security, in the loosest sense of the word, for Drew Galloway. He came to Inverness to do a meet and greet, and literally I just stood at the door and held it open while everyone came in, got their thing signed and left, and he was like the nicest guy. And I'm just sitting here going, if anything does kick off, I am no help to you. I have like zero help to you. I could barely hold myself up, let alone other people. So you're on your own here. And he was so nice. And I don't know, I'm still determined that he didn't know who I was, but I met him a couple of months later because he came back up to Inverness out of the blue. I didn't know he was going to be there. I opened the door and there he was. And he went, oh, how you doing? And seemed to like he knew me. And I was like, you don't know who I am. I've had many strange interactions, but the Drew ones still were my favourites. But yeah, so RVD being up there is just what you see is what you get with RVD, then I'm guessing.
It's also just occurred to me, just really specific, but I remember meeting Zach Gibson on a night out after. I think it would have been, was it Fear and Loathing 9? I think it would have been Fear and Loathing 9. But I remember standing and chatting with him. I was you know, getting pretty close to being towards steaming or whatever. I remember just sitting talking to him about an idea abroad, because he was talking about how he'd been wrestling in China. And then I was like, oh, you must have felt like Carl Pilkington. He was like, I did, you know, do whatever. And then we ended up talking about that for ages. Just weird to think back that this guy that's now next to UK now, whatever, I talked his ear off about Carl Pilkington. But
that's what you find. You find wrestlers generally, outside of like this stuff, they would speak about anything but wrestling. With fans, they would more enjoy doing that, because I had Joey Legend in my car once, and I picked up my wife on the way, because Aberdeen to Inverness, I was taking him, and she spoke to him about musicals for the whole hour, and he was like so buzzing just to speak about anything but wrestling for that hour. And he was talking about like Aladdin, the musical that was in Germany, and I was like, jeez, I didn't even know that was a thing, but apparently it is. So there, and I was just in the front, just hoping I'd get to Inverness without killing anyone. That was kind of my only thought at that point, was just get there. Don't die. I don't know. No one would be responsible for killing Joey Legend after years of hearing stories about being stuck on ice with Edge and Rhino. And here I am on the A96, just wishing I don't kill him. But yeah, so meeting wrestlers is still weird. And now that you're in the wrestling business, if as much as you, even if you want to fight it, you are in it. It must be weird that you meet these guys now and you kind of have to try and maintain some sort of professionalism. I suppose, like, I'm a wrestler, don't want to be, I'm a wrestler, Tay, but like you've got to be like, we're colleagues instead of just being a fanboy.
I guess it's one of those things that's kind of easier to do as time goes on, because I think you realize, like, when you see interactions between like really like super fans who obviously like, you know, meet these guys from whatever and are going crazy, and you can see the guys just going like, Jesus, this is, and you're like, yeah, I can. it humanizes them a lot, and it kind of makes it easier to just be like, yeah, like your exact opposite reaction is to be like, oh, like a fan kind of thing, you know, and to like, yes, yeah, I don't know, like, I guess it's just one of those things that's, you know, everyone's relative. But
and I suppose that as you're pretty much a bad guy everywhere, you haven't had to really deal with that just yet, but I'm assuming there's still going to be some fans outside after shows waiting to get a picture with all the wrestlers. And
I don't know, there's been really nice fans. There's Scottish Kitty, lassie that does like, has done like fan art and stuff for a bunch of the
boys. I've seen her art, it's amazing.
Yeah, no, she's absolute sweetheart. I've still got that in the living room and stuff. Just this, she's, you know, I don't really look that good in photos, but you know, she's managed to make like good in her artwork, so fair play to her. Yeah, no, the fans are lovely. Even like we did a show in Govan the other week, and all the kids are, you know, little crazy Govan kids or whatever, but you know, they were, you know, all just having such a great time, etc. And they're all, you know, dead excited. So no, it's great. Even for a heel or whatever, you know. So
we will definitely speak about Govan, because anytime it's brought up, I've only seen two Govan shows on YouTube, and I can't imagine how people feel being in it, wrestling in front of that crowd, because it's just
it's fun, man.
Nuts.
It's yeah.
So yeah, so a couple matches here and there. You had Soldato in 2019, and then that's
I had Ross Hauser in February of 2019, and then I think I had Solly in March, if I remember correctly.
Well, February 19 is not on Cage Match, so that's
No, I did have a match with Big Ross, which was pretty enjoyable. Just get flung about a lot. Took a back, you know, big back body drop, and I felt like I was in the air for, it felt like about a minute, but you know, just, you know, that was a different type of, to go from wrestling Charlie to wrestling Ross, you couldn't probably have two more like diametrically opposed like styles and sizes, etc. So that was a good kind of test as well.
Especially, I mean, I spoke to Ross last night actually, which will go out in 2 weeks, quite in a week to the people on the actual, who's listening to this and not paid me money to watch him early. But yeah, he was going through his JBL kind of phase. So I'm assuming that the forearm from Charlie might not have been great, but the clothesline from Ross would have been a little snugger.
Funnily enough, like, I don't know if it was just a general over the fact that I was hitting him back or whatever, but there wasn't anything that Ross hit me with that I was like, to be honest, there was actually a worst moment in the match with Soldato where we did an avalanche backdrop and he turned it into a cross body, but he didn't quite get all the way around, so he landed on me like kind of side into the stomach. That was much worse than anything, you know, from the match with Ross. There was another occurrence in there as well. Actually, the day before I had the match with Ross, I was in the Rumble in PWE, which was very fun. I'd never been in a Rumble before, so that was a good laugh. Got to do some sequences and stuff with BT, which was great. Yeah, no, that was really enjoyable. Because Adrian had asked me to be on that show, so that was magic. That was another, like, just talking about like the non-canon match being like a bit of a, you know, like a shot in the arm for like, oh, I can't do this or whatever. That was the first time that coach specifically took me aside and like went, do you specifically want to do this? So that was good, and especially from Adrian, because he was probably my favorite coach, I would say, as well. So no, that was good.
And then I get the vibe from hearing stories about Adrian that he wouldn't have put you on his show, especially if he didn't think you were capable of doing it.
Well, yes, especially because it was his show that added another layer to it. Yeah, it's not like he was asking me to be on like an asylum show or something. So yeah, no, that was great.
So we'll get a little bit of Lionheart stuff just done at this point, because you know it's not going to be I'm hoping there's going to be a nice story or two, because of course there will be, but it's not a particularly happy subject to speak about. So you would have had that match with Soldato the month after, of course Lionheart passed away. So you said he was your favorite coach. What was the atmosphere for that afterwards?
Okay, it was just surreal, man. Like I say, particularly, you know, like all our coaches are great or whatever, but I think Adrian, I don't know if it, like between like him, like BT, Stevie, probably Wolfie, are probably the ones that are like, you know, are probably like enjoyed the classes the most, etc. But I felt like Adrian was the one that believed in me the most. And before he passed away, he actually wanted me and Mikey to team together for the first time. On his next show in air. Yeah, and then so it was just even more of a shock to just go from that to suddenly just he was gone. It was it was rough. I got a call when I was at work. It was Charlie that phoned me actually. And I guess to put this in context, some of the boys had found out about Adrian quite quickly. Charlie was one of the ones that got phoned kind of second tier after that, and he tried to phone me first, but I was in work, so I couldn't answer the phone. And he phoned Mikey next and basically went, this is happened to Adrian, etc. And I think Mikey's first question was, have you told Rab? Which kind of, yeah, puts that in a context, I guess. Mm-hmm. But yeah, no, it was rough, man. It was just out of nowhere, and well, there you go.
Yeah, I mean, for of course, because I'm a fan, so I would have found out when it was on like national news, which, well, like, it was in actual like the papers and stuff, which shows his legacy and what he brought to Scottish wrestling, British wrestling in general. But yeah, I mean, for someone like myself who'd only seen him wrestle, maybe he went walked by me once, the last WrestleZone show that he was at, and it broke my heart to watch. I couldn't imagine guys like yourself and guys that had wrestled him as well, thinking, Jesus, that's, if this is breaking my heart, and I'd only passing met him, I can't imagine what it would be like for you guys. Did you find it was difficult to get you back motivated wrestling, or did you find that because he believed in you, you're like, well, I can't give this up, I'm just going to just play, must get well, that
was,
back
that,
into
that
it.
That was part of, you know, a kind of good motivation of like, no, I'm going to keep going. Like, obviously Adrian's gone, but, you know, he believed in me, so I'll believe in myself kind of thing. It was more just the kind of absence going forward, I guess, of like, you know, because there'd obviously still be, you have those little momentary kind of re-realizations, if it makes sense. When you get in a position, you've kind of almost forgotten about it, and then you're hit by that realization again, which are kind of sometimes worse than the initial kind of realization. So it was, you know, sometimes we'd be in training or whatever, we'd do a drill, and I'd maybe think of like, it would come into my head like what Adrian would have said, or like if we do a drill that we'd done with him or something, I'd kind of hear him like, good Rab, or something like that, you know, in that, you know, classic kind of Lionheart voice or whatever. They just, you know, yeah, just, those were kind of tougher little pangs or whatever to deal with, but a solid foundation to build on, so that's, I couldn't have asked for any more.
Absolutely. So is that, and the next match I've got after that is you and Mikey teaming up. So was that pretty much like, as he suggested it, as Adrian suggested it before his passing, was that you and Mikey just going, right, we're just gonna do this then. We're gonna
we had tied together quite a lot in training, just because I think of Mikey's style, he's quite good at controlling matches kind of on the ground, and then more kind of striking wise, that's more my thing, because we look similar, because also we just do these training matches, whatever, a lot of the time just it would be like, oh, Rab and Mikey, why don't you just go together, we seem to have good chemistry, etc. I think that's what obviously what Adrian saw, everyone wanted to put us on that show, but then also wasn't until a couple of months later I don't know, we had a bit of a more of an influx of singles guys at that time, whereas there weren't as many tag teams, so I think they felt like, oh, this could be a good thing to kind of build more tag teams out of the asylum or whatever. So if I remember correctly, our first tag match was against Luke and Paul.
What I've got written down.
The Bathgate boys, as they were known unofficially. Paul, who I found out the other day, is a wrestling champion in Texas now. Dustin Rhodes' wrestling school. It's crazy.
Is that Paul Hubris?
Paul Hubris, yeah.
Ah, right.
I was on Instagram the other day, and it, like, you know, scroll by whatever, and I was like, I thought it was like a suggested post for something to do with Dustin Rhodes. And I was like, well, that's weird or whatever. And then I was like, no, it doesn't say suggested. It says like, I know this person, Paul Hubris. Who's that? Whatever, tagged in. I was like, one of the first pictures was like Paul in the asylum. I was like, what's going on here? This is great. Yeah. It's so weird.
I had the same kind of thing, because I was like, oh, this Scottish guy's won a wrestling championship. I'll go follow him on Twitter. I was already following him. I was going, I don't remember following that guy at all. And now you've connected the dots now. So that is wild.
You can thank that for that sick comeback that me and Mikey gave him for that match. You know, he's never looked back since. So there you go.
Well, I'm going to write it down. I'm going to see if I can get him on for season 4. That's happening. Right. There you go. That's so weird. Okay, cool. Right, that's that. So Smashing Brothers then. What I got from Mikey pretty much was, you're the ideas guy when it comes to names and what have you. So Smashing Brothers, what was the thought behind that?
There wasn't a lot of thought behind it, man, to be honest. We got thrown together quite, like, obviously because we'd been tagged in training, but nobody specifically said to us, like, oh, like, we want to make you guys a team or whatever. It just came up on the card, like, oh, you know, Rab and Mikey against Luke and Paul. And it's like, what are we going to... I think somebody joked before about, like, oh, they look at the Bashing Brothers. Oh, no, but you'd be the Smashing Brothers or whatever. That it just... We're like, cool, we just use that. Like, sure, yeah, it's like we don't know if we'll even like team together for very long or if it'll actually work or whatever. So let's just go with that. But yeah, very, very much a temporary name. I still like it, but yeah, no, maybe a bit too generic looking back, etc. So, but you know, it did what it had to at the time.
Yeah, and well, this is where when me and Mikey were speaking, where we just ended up going into bald talk for far too long, probably. So I was thinking, when you said, may you said Basham Brothers, that's just kicked my memory back up. But yeah, that's pretty much what he was saying as well. And Basham Brothers isn't their tag team. At least you didn't go for the pleather gear. Pleather. No. I don't know who could have volunteered to be Shaniqua. Is it Shaniqua?
Fell enough. Shame on A's volunteered to be the Shaniqua for our tag team. So he seems pretty buzzing about that. So who knows? Maybe we'll come back as the Smashing Brothers one day, and we'll have Shaniqua, I guess, would be the
My thought was tall, muscly, long hair. Clearly it's Flex Hunter getting a comeback. We can get him and get him with a whip, you know. Shame on A's Shaniqua.
You know, like that meme of like you're smoking the fag and just like, I've not heard that name in years. That's how I feel about Flex Hunter. Like, dear me, Flex was a character. There's been a lot of characters at the Asylum at the time I've been there. Flex was definitely literally and figuratively one of the bigger ones.
Ross can get a wig. Big Ross can be Shaniqua. That's a shuddering thought. We'll move on. But it came to like tag teams. I mean, the next two matches I have written down anyway for your Wrestling Experience Scotland stuff was the two pretty much two other tag teams that have come out of FPWA, GPWA. We've got the Govan team and then the Purge as well. So. Yeah. When you started teaming as the Smashing Brothers, and you thought it might not last that long, and then you're in these matches with some of the more established tag teams from GPWA, what point did you think, oh no, this is actually going to be our thing now? I'm a tag team guy now.
To be fair, so like saying like I didn't know if we'd tag that long. Like as soon as we had the match, we're looking ball, and it went really well. I felt like our chemistry again. Like it's different having things in training and then actually being in the ring and seeing how it goes to the crowd and stuff. But no, we're like, cool, no, this definitely works. Let's roll with this. Especially again with like an influx of singles guys and stuff. It was like, no, this could be our thing to move forward, And tag team wrestling offers its own type of challenges, etc. Which is always interesting. More combinations, etc. Just more moving parts that you have to it was the Govan team and the Purge. Both really very different matches, very different opponents, which was, and enjoyed both of those matches a lot.
And as Mikey said, it wasn't that difficult to get booed because these guys are so like loved by the crowd and you guys are bald.
Exactly. We just had to go out there and just be bald and the crowd were just effervescent for it. They just couldn't get enough of it, seemingly. Especially like we got even more of that that Govan show I was telling you about, because there were three of us who were bald and we were against like basically like hometown heroes, so that was volcanic. That was very enjoyable. Being bald's great, honestly. It's you're so aerodynamic, it's easy to be a heel, it's just it ticks all these boxes. It's good stuff.
That's the thing, is that I try to refrain from such chants because it's like console with four eyes when you've got glasses. It defeats the purpose if I'm shouting at someone that they're bald by being bald at the same time. Yeah. But I was saying to Mikey that your team kind of reminded me of like just your look as FTR, and then I was realizing it's because you're bald. But was there any tag teams that when you thought right when you got had the match, you thought, oh, this could be a thing. Was there any tag teams that you tried to watch and try to get some ideas from for tag team moves or just little things?
A lot of the times we've come up with moves and stuff have just been messing about the ring and training, etc. But I like to look back at like kind of like classic tag teams like the Hart Foundation and stuff like that. Bunch of matches from like All Japan when it was like Kobashi and Misawa and stuff would tag together. There's no specific tag team I don't think I could say are like my favorite of all time, but I do have a bunch of them, if you know what I mean. So there's no specific tag team that went like, oh, we'll just like we'll just wholesale take their moves or like their style or whatever. There's so much different stuff with tag team wrestling as well, so many different combinations, etc., that it's always fun to try and come up with the intricacies of timing, of placement, of where's the opponent going to be, why would the other guy not be trying to break this up, are you using the five count, or are you within the rules but like still cheating within the rules kind of thing. There's a lot to it. It's great. I don't enjoy tag team wrestling.
Yeah, so at this point I've just got, there's a drop off of nothingness because the pandemic hit. Was there any other companies that you're able to get to in that I haven't mentioned so far? Because Target seems to grab a lot of guys from GPWA and anything like that.
No, that's pretty much there's been other wee things, like went down for like a rumble at PCW and stuff. That was Adrian's tribute show. Nothing specific. Obviously, like you know, the pandemic just wiped everyone out, kind of thing. Which was annoying because we'd kind of built a bit of momentum there. You know, we just had the match with the Pudge. Things were really kind of coming together, and then just obviously nothingness. Our first match really back there was the one at CPW the other week.
So we'll get to that. We'll fill in the blank in between then. So 20 months of nothing. Yep. How did you fill your time then? And there's no gymming for a majority of it. There's no shows to go to or nowhere to train. How did you find your pandemic?
For a while, like fitness wise, I would try to do like card workouts, or even just like sets of things and stuff in the house, just to kind of. But then as time went on, and it also became apparent that, you know, we weren't getting a lockdown anytime soon for an extended period of time, it kind of fell by the wayside. But then for a little while, one of my friends lives around the corner from me, and he got a home gym put in. So I would go around to his and we'd work out and stuff there. And this was during the period where for the first 7-8 months of the pandemic, I was furloughed, which was great and absolutely awful at the same time, because also there's having so much time, and then there's just having so much time. Played through all the Dark Souls, just played a ton of video games, to be honest. I hadn't really gamed for a while, so that kind of reignited my passion for that, which was great. I'd never played the Dark Souls games specifically before. In fact, I'd always kind of made fun of my friends who played them, like, oh, you think you're so special because you play a really hard game, like, oh, well done you. And then I played them and I was like, no, these are actually incredible. Like, fair play. Yeah, no, this is, I can see why you like these. I don't really know what else to say about the pandemic, man. It's just nothingness. It was terrible.
But speaking of games, yeah, I mean, if anyone checks my PlayStation trophy count, I rattled through. I love the Lego games. That's my jam. I'm not into Dark Souls. Give me something nice and pleasant to play. You just pop up in the exact same place again. And I think I must have completed about maybe 6 of them. Like from PS, because I had PlayStation Now for a little bit, so I rattled through all the PS3 ones, and then rattled through all the other PS3 downstairs, because my office at that point was just a corner in the living room, because I'm thinking, oh, it's a week or so, oh, it's a month or so, it's 2 months or so, and then by 6 months my wife was like, you find a way to get that computer upstairs, because I am not sitting in the living room with that anymore, because it was just a dining table that just rattled every time you typed. So I had to go I was about to say steal, but I do know I have it. I'd take a desk from work, and this is my office now with all my crap in the background. Lego games, and then I did a load 2K20 stuff on WWE and made a bunch of folk. Then June arrived, and I had to delete a bunch of folk. So I didn't really go well at that point. But a lot of gaming. So Dark Souls, Uncharted as well. Uncharted was free. PlayStation put them out, so I end up rattling through those again, and I love those games so much. So Dark Souls, and what's your other gaming, what's your non-Dark Souls gaming habits then?
Just now I've been trying to get the Platinum for Final Fantasy X, which has been an undertaking. That is a long-ass grind for that Platinum. I discovered Persona while the pandemic was on as well, which I'd heard people talk about Persona 5 for years, about how it was amazing or whatever, and it was another one, like you say, it wasn't free, but it was on sale, And I was like, oh, it's like a just like a tenner. Might as well just pick up and see what it's like. 200 hours later, just like that was the best thing ever. That was incredible. Then I got a whole bunch of games. In terms of like, I guess the equivalent for me Lego wise, you would be like, I did all the platinums to the trilogy of Spyro games, like the remastered trilogy. Just oh man, childhood just came back. It was beautiful.
I found out very quickly how bad I am at the flight ones in Spyro. Oh,
the worst. Yeah. Once you have to go in and like collect 10 of whatever thing, or you have to work out the route and stuff. Oh, terrible.
No, that's where I drew the line with Spyro. It's like I really enjoyed the games. Just let me enjoy them. I'm never going to plot them in because I'm rubbish at the flight ones. Yeah. So I thought I'm just going to enjoy the experience for what it is. Same with Crash. I realized I loved Crash growing up, but it must be like a memory that I've implanted that I remember I was terrible at it. So I bought it, started playing it, going, I'm rubbish at Crash. Why did I ever enjoy playing this game? I hate it.
This is the thing. There's actually there's a thing to do with the way that it's mapped. So like the physics engine that they've used for the remastered Crash 1 part of that, they've pulled from Crash 3. So like, but they've pulled the maps from Crash 1. So basically things don't line up quite as well as they should. Because I remember playing it and being like, this is solid, man. Like, was this solid when I was a kid? Like, I seem to remember this was a lot easier. But no, apparently there's like a legitimate reason why it seems a lot harder now, particularly Crash 1, the remastered one. So you should feel a little bit better about it.
I will, but no, Spyro, I end up getting all on the PS1, so I play on my Vita as well. I got a Vita during just before the pandemic. So, I have
been people to have a PS Vita. Jesus.
I don't know. Well, it was one of those times where I was just like, I kept seeing one pop up and I thought I would love just to get a Vita and just play these PS1 games. And then I think I just kept talking about it so much. I went to CEX or however you're supposed to say it. Went in and there it was. There was one for £60. And I was like,
why not?
Yeah, I'm just going to get a Vita. Why not? It was right about my birthday. So I was able to go, that's my birthday present then. If you want to get me that, I'll have a Vita. And then I think I played it for about a year and I have not played it since. Because I like Fortnite now, unfortunately, so I play Fortnite.
I've only ever played Fortnite for one round once and I got killed immediately, and that's as far as I've ever gotten into Fortnite. So I don't know, like I can understand why other people like it. I guess it's just not something that jumps out to me.
Oh, I hated it for so long, and then I think speaking to Zach Dynamite for one of these interviews, and he just said it was amazing. And I spoke to Aspen Faith, and he said the same. And you know, Aspen Faith is one of my favorite wrestlers, so I was like, "Well, if he likes it, I'll play it too." And then now I'm like 300 levels in, and I play it most nights. And like, I don't know what's happened to me.
You're in too deep.
I mean, yeah, exactly. I'm at this point where if I don't play it, I'm going to miss out on a Deadpool skin or something like that. And even though I collect all these things, I've got Captain America quite early on and I haven't changed it since, because why would you? You get a little vibranium shield and it's Captain America. Why would it be any other character?
I guess you did say we would talk about Marvel, so...
Well, I mean, you brought it up, so...
I'm always interested to hear people's take on Marvel, especially... with what's happening with Phase 4, etc., an interesting time.
Okay, so we'll go with the maybe not less controversial stuff than pre-Phase 4. any particular favorite movies? I mean, we'll take the Avengers films itself out because, you know, they're amazing anyway. Even Age of Ultron, I don't care what anyone else says.
Funnily enough, part of the way that I spent my time during the pandemic was doing a complete rewatch of the MCU and ranking them as they went along and increasing the list or whatever. So number one, undoubtedly, is Guardians of the Galaxy, volume one, 100%. Just the best mix of just great varied team, great villain, just great story, so many different aspects to it. It kind of feels like pro wrestling in a way that, you know, it's like the circus, you know, if you don't like the lions, you like the, you know, the candies, you don't like the cans, you like the clowns or whatever, just because like the team, there's something for everybody. Guardians one, definitely.
That one's got a soft spot in my heart. It was the first cinema date I had with my wife. That was our first film to go to see in 3D, right? Guardians of the Galaxy. I've got it, where have I got it? Because I've got a list as well, because everyone does. Where have I got Guardians of the Galaxy? I've got number six.
Nice. Okay, I'm going to say, I think think I got a new phone since I made the list, but I'll check if it's transferred the note.
We won't go through all 31 franchises.
No, I know.
But yeah,
I guess most important, what's top of your list and what's bottom of your list?
Endgame. It has to be Portals, just for Portals alone, really.
If you had to take out the Avengers film, so
Winter Soldier.
Nice. I think that was number 3 on my list. I want to say.
So taking them out, I've got taking out the Avengers ones. I've got Winter Soldier, Ragnarok, and I love Spider-Man. So Far From Home is next after that. You may be able to tell from the artwork on my arm that I do love Spider-Man, and everywhere. That's Amazing Spider-Man. That was a very poor choice.
I've got the weeb stuff going on instead. I got some full metal and some. I appreciate a man of taste who has a themed sleeve of some type.
I know. Well, it was supposed to be I was hoping to make it a sleeve eventually, and this would be my lockdown. I had 4 tattoos before I started, and now I've got them all over the place. And yeah. That's how I spend my money, because I'm not going anywhere or going out till I just go to get that. Phase 4 then.
And what was bottom of your list?
Oh, bottom. Incredible Hulk.
I think that was, I feel like it was like second or third bottom for me.
Dark World. Is next, and then yep. It's Eternals.
I've not seen Eternals yet, but this is exactly the Phase 4 stuff. Bottom for me, 100%, was Iron Man 3.
I liked it.
Absolutely. Well, to be fair, I think the reason that it's bottom for me particularly is because I feel like it's half an amazing movie, then half an absolute awful one. As soon as they do that switch from the Ben Kingsley Mandarin that you've seen for the first half of the film. I remember being so hyped because I remember I used to watch the Iron Man cartoon that was on Fox Kids and stuff when I was a kid, and obviously it was always like the Mandarin and whatever. So when we were finally getting that, I was like, oh, sick, I'm finally going to get to see the Mandarin. The MCU is going to be so good. And then when it was Ben Kingsley, it was the thing of like almost like a kind of modern day terrorist and stuff. I was like, oh man, like that's, it's like a really kind of cool interpretation. Like, it's going to be sick. Like, oh my God, in the first half of the movie, this is so good. What do you mean he's from Liverpool? What?
I think if you like the source material, like for me, when I was growing up watching cartoons and that, it was X-Men, which has got it's now coming back as a reboot, as a continuation, which I'm all hyped for, and Spider-Man. They were the two I watched. So I didn't see an Iron Man cartoon or anything like that.
They were all on Fox Kids. They were all on the same channel. I think the Iron Man one only had like a season or two, though I don't think it got as popular. And just like fell away. But yeah, the Spider-Man, I rewatched a lot of the old X-Men cartoon pretty recently as well. Like, a lot of it still holds up, man. It's especially the theme tune, obviously.
I just said I liked it, and I'm just looking at my list. I've got it as number 28. So I don't like it that much, clearly. But I thought I did. Thor is the one above that. So I don't think that's right. I might switch them around. Anyway, the Marvel films, Phase 4. The last one you'd seen, I'm guessing, then would be Shang-Chi.
Didn't see Shang-Chi.
I haven't seen Shang-Chi.
I haven't seen Shang-Chi. I've heard good things about it.
Yeah, Shang-Chi's
just the last time I went to the cinema was to see Godzilla vs. King Kong. I went to see it in the IMAX, and a lot of the speakers and stuff were broken, so it was the quietest monster battle that you've ever heard. I don't know if that's just slightly dampened the cinema right now. I went to see Black Widow. I can't remember if that was after Godzilla and King Kong, but definitely around the same time. Although I want to go and see Dune, actually. That's probably there. But so the last Marvel film I would assume would have been Black Widow.
I enjoy it. It's one I've seen twice, because we went down to Edinburgh the week after seeing it, and it was one of those. It was the last day, and we're like, we can't really be bothered. We were quite hungover. And we were just like, I can't be bothered sitting about waiting for a train all day. Where will we do humping our bags to? Oh, the cinema's not that far away. We'll just go to the cinema. What's on? Black Widow. We'll just watch Black Widow then. It's a View cinema. It's a £5 ticket. We as well. We'll just go in there and see it.
I thought it was okay, but it really should have been like Phase 3.
Oh, yeah. I think
yeah.
Would have appreciated it more if it was out before, Endgame. But no, at the moment, I'm just sitting, as of recording, I'm sitting waiting patiently for, I think it's 1:30 in the morning, the Spider-Man trailer is supposed to come out in the UK.
Oh, yeah.
So there's a grown-up part of me thinking, you'll see it in the morning, go to sleep at a reasonable hour. But there's another part going, oh, but if I make it to 11:30, I'd be as well stay up an hour, 2 hours and watch.
Yeah, it's only like 2 hours. I'll just have a power nap and then just, you know, just watch it, yeah.
Exactly. Treat it like a pay-per-view night and just,
tactical, yeah.
But no, I'm so hyped for it.
That last draw, just the Hello, Peter. Oh, just... Spider-Man 2 is undoubtedly my favourite Spider-Man movie, 100%. So good. So to see Alfred Molina back as Doc Ock is incredible.
Conveniently, only one not on Netflix. They have all the other ones.
Yeah.
The absolute cheek of them, because I wanted to watch, I mean, I've got them on Blu-ray, but I wanted to watch them all and see them before the new one comes out. And I'm like, I'm going to have to actually go into a cupboard to get this to actually watch it. It's how very dare they. But I think that completes the Marvel section for the moment.
Sure.
I'm sure that if we come back to it, we might do, because I'm checking the time and thinking, well, we've sped through quite amount of time, but more speed. So I'll get my two ridiculous questions out of the way then while we're at this section. What's your favorite dinosaur?
Favorite dinosaur? That's a good question.
It's not, but thank you.
No, it's actually a great question. My girlfriend loves playing Jurassic World on the PS4 and stuff, so she's always going on about dinosaurs and stuff, and it actually looks really cool. I should really play it as well. Dinosaurs immediately made me think of the Power Rangers, though.
Oh, yeah.
So I feel like I probably have to go Triceratops.
Nice. Blue Ranger. Billy the Blue Ranger. That's always a good shout.
My favorite was always the Black Ranger and Mastodon, but again, Mastodon's not a dinosaur, so I can't pick that one. But no, Triceratops is pretty sick as well, man. Like, yeah, just...
Speaking of dinosaurs, I may be able to see for anyone watching, I've got Dino Pool in the background, because as soon as I saw that, I've done so many of these questions now of who's your favorite dinosaur, what's your favorite dinosaur, I saw that in Asda and I was like, I have to get that. That has to be in my background now, a little dinosaur. I mean, it has to be there. But no, that's a good choice. Power Rangers, Mighty Morphin, even better. I was always a Red Ranger guy, but I liked Jason and I liked Red, so that's pretty much that was it. And it was Triceratops.
I was a Black Ranger and a Green Ranger guy. Although the memes always see now about like that the Green Ranger played his flute through his dagger with his helmet on and stuff just makes me laugh. So what else? But the Dragonzord's so cool. So.
I didn't realize till recently, very recently, that in the actual. Where they take the footage from the actual Japanese show, the Ranger was supposed to be a dude. I never clicked with me until very recently. I was like,
Because the Pink Ranger's the only one with a skirt.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah, it's Super Sentai. I want to say do you remember some of the other like TV shows at the time that got ripped off from these type of shows? There was like Big Bad Beetleborgs, VR Triples.
Mask Rider.
Yep, they tried to do that same formula, just tried to recreate Power Rangers, just lightning a ball. Can't recreate that.
Beetleborgs, jeez, that's a throwback. That was my mornings, Saturday mornings. I'd watch that, and then Teenage Mutant Hero Turtles, not Ninja, it was Hero Turtles back in my day, and Gargoyles. You know, all the Street Sharks. You know, all the classics.
Yeah, just all the anthropomorphized animals. They definitely did. Probably explains the amount of furries that have popped up around our age, probably, after thinking about this. great era for TV in general. It's one of it, like the X-Men series, Spider-Man series. That would have been the first time I really got into anime and stuff, and Dragon Ball Z and stuff would have been on as well. Just, yeah, good times.
It's trying to draw that line between do you sit and watch cartoons all day or do you call it animated so it makes it sound like you're a grown up? Same time, isn't it?
I will readily admit that I love cartoons and anime, so it's all good. I've got it all covered, man.
Do you have toys or action figures? Oh, well, they're clearly action figures because, you know, I'm grown up now. the other question we asked...
actually collectibles, so...
Yeah. Oh, that's the worst. That's the worst one. It's like, why don't you take your pops out of the box? Well, they're collectible, you know.
It's actually a mint condition, never removed from box, so you wouldn't understand.
How to lose friends so quickly. Another question we ask people is, what would win a fight, two sheep or one cow?
The cow, 100%. With the weight advantage, like, yeah, those two sheep are getting double choke slammed. They're getting, you know, they're getting flung about, man. Just, I've only really appreciated recently. So, like, I've got two dogs now, and one of them has the weight advantage on the other, and it is just not even close in a fight, man. So, yeah, no, that cow is going to be slapping those sheep about, man. Just getting flung over barbed wire fences and stuff like that. It's going to be a massacre, a moosica, if you will.
Moosica. Ah, yeah. Wonderful. What kind of dog have you got?
Two pugs.
Dogs. Sorry, two pugs.
Yeah. Ponyo and Mochi. They are both very cute, but Mochi is... I think she's just scared. Yeah, you are. She's like a rescue, so she's kind of scared of everything, which then leads to aggression when she sees Ponyo or she feels like she's getting more attention. So we've had to kind of keep them separate for a week or so now because... Yeah, Ponyo wasn't really standing a chance. It was a bit of a shame.
I've got one. I've got a Beagle Lab cross called Sandy Claus.
Nice.
Because my wife loves Nightmare Before Christmas.
Yep. Heading up Sandy Claus. Nice.
Yeah, that's it. So, and she's one of those. It's so funny because when she was really young, she's scared of water, like bodies of water. She won't go into the sea or go near a edge because when I took her out for a walk, or one of her first walks, we went around a park, and she was quite happy looking at this pond, and then suddenly found herself in the pond, and from that point forward she will not go near bodies of water. so beaches are out for walks, which I don't mind. I hate beaches, so give me wood.
I'm not massive on beaches either. Well, I wasn't until we started taking the dogs to the beach, and man, that's like a dog wonderland. They just love that shit.
That's why I like the woods, because she'll go sniffing, because she's a Beagle Lab. She loves to sniff things and all that kind of stuff. So they go wild, and I don't feel like I've got sand everywhere afterwards. And I don't mind getting muddy. Yeah, Sandy Claus. That's it. But yeah, speaking about fear, I think at some point I must have opened a cupboard on her in the kitchen, because every time I open a particular cupboard, she just leaves the room. Just like going, I'm going to get hit by that thing again. So, dogs are weird. They're funny. They're amazing, but they're weird at the same time.
100%.
Wrestling. It's the wrestling podcast. So, community pro wrestling. We mentioned it briefly as well, and Govan being absolute. I've used the word feral, but I always find when I say it, it may be a bit offensive to some people. But
to be honest, with the stuff that people in Govan say to each other, I don't think feral even... registers on their list, to be honest. So
it's a mix of sugar and feralness. What was it like getting in front of a crowd again after that long?
Oh man, it was so great. It was so good. Even the sales, particularly because it's like they would already kind of hated us because we were bald, and they were. I don't know if it was a combination of. The kids were so excited and stuff, and that people had been inside for, you know, so long, and this is maybe their first wrestling show back and stuff as well, and to be in Govan and whatever, but they were just molten hot. And then we were against Big Ross, Darrow, and Spider Bam as he went by, which is one of the boys' stick from the Asylum. But he's like a hometown boy and whatever. So, just that they absolutely loved all three of them. They hated us. It was just a nice, easy, but cool match to do. No, it was great. It was the first time my nephew had ever got to see me wrestle as well, which was great. He was dressed up as 2001 Kane, which just added to everyone. He's a kid of immaculate taste. He's only 8 years old, but man, he knows his stuff, honestly. He's got like one of those brains where he just remembers everything that he's ever seen, and he's like arguing with me about like who held the WWE title in what year, and I'm like, Matthew, you've got me in this, man. I can't remember that. Like, fair play, and this is like 20 years before you were born. Like, sure.
I love that. I think, but back in my youth, I may be able to do the same thing, but I'm now in my 30s. I'm 31, but I'm just in my 30s, and now, if it happened in the last week, I might remember it. That's about it now. My memory's all gone for that kind of stuff. So you're back, Community Pro Wrestling, but a new team name. you know, Casino Brutale. Mikey wasn't sure how this came about. He was kind of told, and he went, "Aye, okay, that sounds fine."
Mikey was all aboard with us, to be fair. Like you may said, like I come up with a lot of the ideas and stuff. Trying to like toot my own horn thing or whatever. But just I don't know. I had this idea. Obviously, like, well, we had this downtime. I was like, cool, like, what can we do to kind of stand out more? Smash and Brothers is a bit kind of generic. Like, maybe this is time, you know, kind of take a next step and kind of evolve, etc. And I can't even remember exactly where it came from, but I was kind of thinking to myself, and I was like, it was something to do with thinking about the pandemic and how, like, you hadn't had any options and stuff, and, like, you hadn't been able to gamble on anything. I was like, has anybody ever done, like a gambling character? Has that ever been done? And, you know, I looked the kind of stuff up, and the only person I could find was a WCW jobber called The Gambler, who didn't even gamble. He literally just went out and just got his head kicked in. So I was like, you know, this could be something to examine or whatever. And I was like, cool, like, how would this work with Mikey? And I was like, okay, like, you know, we could extend this. I was like, you know, I had this idea, like, you know, I could be like the house always wins. That's like a total asshole thing a heel would say. Like, that's good. That could, you know, tie in. Like, we could go in, like, an APA kind of direction with it. Like, if it's trying to think of, like, I could go into, like, make it, like, sleazy, like a type of, like, loan shark gambling, just horrible character, basically. And it's like, this could really have kind of legs and stuff. And then I talked to Mikey about it, and it's like, we could play this off, because I don't want to make it seem like Mikey's anyway lesser than me. You know, he's, you know, we're teammates and whatever. Don't want to make it seem like I'm like the leader of a two-man group, because that's not the thing. So it's like, so how do we keep each other on a kind of level, pegging, etc. I kind of talked to Mikey about it, and he loved it. We ran it by Wolfgang, and he seemed to really enjoy it. And we hadn't actually thought of a name at that point. I'd thought of a couple of names, and he kind of went, "What have you got?" And one of the first ones I said was like, "Oh, like Casino Brutale." And he went, "Yeah, go with that one, because like you know exactly what you're all about." Yeah, so that's what we're running with now. You know, we kind of get new gear and stuff. My girlfriend was nice enough to like make me this like homemade jacket with pink feathers and stuff. It's sick. I think it's just a better all round character and gives us more to play with, kind of thing. So that's the change.
So I think I tried to throw in the tagline of "If you get in the ring with you, it's a gamble." You know who?
Yeah. You're going to be rolling loaded dice, etc. I thought it was so much fun. Man, it's insane. Listen to so much entrance music, like just try, you know, think of stuff that would fit in with this, etc. Try to think of different stupid spots to do and whatever. Like, if we're on a family show, we could like roll dice and, well, you know, whatever. Just all this stuff, but. Like I say, that, again, even from that, like, there's just so much more to work with than just "grr, we smash brothers, grr," like, you know, just, yeah.
We might have a bit of Kenny Rogers and the Gambler on. The Gambler. That's the only time I've ever heard of the Gambler was through Wrestle Crap. I don't know if you've ever read that. But yeah. They used to put up, like, the worst thing. Man Mountain Rock always seemed to appear somehow. But yeah, that's a blast. I might not watch that. I'll stick with Survivor Series 2005. Okay, so well, looking into the future then, we've covered Rabu Romero's wrestling. We've covered MCU as much as we're going to, because otherwise, this podcast will just be about Marvel films, which I won't mind, but I don't think my audience will particularly enjoy, seeing as it's a wrestling podcast and website.
Man, that's it. Time to branch out. You've got so many people get two different podcasts or do different, you know, video channels and stuff. Do the MCU and do wrestling. I mean, come on, you've got to diversify.
Well, I don't want to
talk with you about the MCU till the cows come home. So sign me up for that.
I don't want to spoil anything for anyone, but I think me and Kelly are going to do that as our spin-off thing. And I don't know how we're going to work out with guests, but I will bear that in mind, because it seems to be a hot topic for every guest I have. If it's not MCU, it's like Jeff Hardy gets mentioned. It's pretty much that's the key things always get brought up. But yeah, so look into the future then. Of course, you're in Community Pro Wrestling. I'm assuming that's not over, because they've got another show coming up that I'm guessing you're going to be a part of. But do you have a bucket list of companies in the Scotland, the UK that you want to get to, or what's your 5-year plan? Is there an end game for everything?
5 years, man, that's a long time. But in the next couple of years, like to wrestle obviously for the big ones, you know, like ICW. If it was down in England, I guess would are Progress still big? I don't know. I guess they'd still be the big English promotion, wouldn't they? Rev Pro, stuff like that. I'd like to, you know, to like wrestle in other countries and stuff if the opportunity came up. Like, you know, some of the boys have gone to like Germany and done stuff with WXW, or gone to like over the top wrestling and stuff like that. Yeah, just get on more shows, do more tag stuff with Mikey, particular opponents and stuff. Obviously, like, there's lots of people we like to wrestle, you know, main event shows, hold some kind of title. There's a whole bunch of stuff, man. Like, even one of the things was to be on a podcast, so that's just, you know, that's scored off. That's always good. Yeah, no, just with things cycling back up, like, we seem to be building a little bit of momentum again, so who knows where it could go within 5 years, you know. Hopefully pretty far.
So I mean it's weird this time in wrestling in general. Now, it's back when we started watching, it was like there's no chance there's gonna be a British guy that would or Scottish guy especially would be in WWE. And of course we had Roddy Piper for years, who's, you know, technically not Scottish. Actually not even technically, he's not Scottish.
He's just not Scottish.
But nowadays you've got WWE Network, you can be an ICW and you're on the network, you're on Peacock in front of millions of people potentially. You can NXT UK is across the border, and it's a great time to be a wrestler where there's so many opportunities. And of course you've got AEW, you've got Impact, you've got Japan. Is Japan, it seems you like your Japanese anime and all that stuff.
I would love to wrestle in Japan, man. Yeah, I don't like, it's crazy how much more open these pathways seem to bigger promotions and stuff now. Like, this is, you know, I wish I'd started wrestling younger, but like you say, you know, like when we'd have started watching, because I'm going to be 31 at the end of the month, so we're pretty much exactly the same age. I couldn't have imagined possibly, you know, beginning wrestling in Scotland and somehow ending up working for WWE or whatever. So yeah, a lot of exciting things opening up for people. So, and then obviously, as people move out, there's a lot more mobility for other new talent to come in and new opportunities in Scotland and the UK, etc. So, exciting time.
I mean, just look at Paul.
Look at Paul Hubris. We have to send him a message and go, well done. Ever since that tag match, that's what set you on the way. You know,
exactly. So, I mean, he's went through the worst of it. He did SSW, and now he's now winning titles and hanging out with Dustin Rhodes. And yeah, I mean, that's Black Rain. I mean, he actually, scrap that. I'm sorry, Dustin, if you ever listen to this. I never mentioned Black Rain.
I mean seven. I mean, you know, like, yeah.
Thanks. You saw the bottom of the barrel and thought, no, we're just going to break through that and just get seven in there. How they got away with it? Well, they didn't get away with it for very long. Anyway, so I've got a feeling that if we keep chatting, I could be here for hours and we'll speak about nothing that people will particularly want to listen to, but I'll be enthralled and we'll speak for hours. But we'll kind of try and wrap up then. So last question I ask people now, I remember, is you're in the main event of WrestleMania. You get to pick your opponent. Who is it?
Does it have to be somebody that's in WWE now, or just anybody?
I think I've kind of went, if it's possible. So as in, if they're alive. It's kind
of... Oh, sweet. 100% me versus Charlie Weiss. Bookending my career. I start my match against Charlie. I have the main event of WrestleMania against him. There you go.
Easy. That's...
100%.
There you go. So yeah, that's this. I've had an absolute blast speaking to this evening. But before we go, where can people find you on social media? Where can people find more about yourself and about Casino Brutale?
Oh man, it's all pretty easy. Pretty much all the social media. Just nobody has a name even approaching Rabu Romero. So it's literally just on everything, just the one word, Rabu Romero. Yeah, just Rabu Romero, all one word on Twitter, Facebook, Instagram. It's mainly Instagram I've been using these days. I'm terrible at keeping up with social media. Like, my girlfriend's amazing at it. She's got like however many followers and stuff, like, so I've been trying to post more content, etc. But yeah, just Rabu Romero for anything. And I don't know if we'll probably create a Casino Brutale page going forward or something, but just now I think Mikey's is literally just Mikey Divine as well. So you know, you'll get the details on either of those pages essentially.
Excellent. Well, perfect. Well, thank you very much for joining me today.
Thanks very much, man. It's been a blast. Thanks for having me on.